Hi, my name is Markus Biel. I'm a Java developer and a software craftsman since 2001. Today I would like to show you how to properly handle exceptions in Java. Most books about programming don't really explain exception handling. It seems like exception handling is just some nasty cleanup stuff, and you would see just some auto-generated exception handling code with print stack trace. Because exception handling is just in the way of the real topic. And I really think that exception handling is a very important topic that only a few developers probably can do. So today I would like to show you how to do it. And yeah, let's just start. Okay, here you see I have a little class prepared for you. Class training. It has a public process method that would call two private methods, process 1 and process 2, just as an example. In process 1, we created a reader, and we're trying to read from the reader. And you see, there's an unhandled exception, a Java I/O exception. An I/O exception is a checked exception. Java, unlike most other programming languages, has checked exceptions. That would mean that the compiler enforces that you have to handle the exception, or you have to at least declare it. So what most people do then, in this case, they would say add exception to the method signature. And the problem is gone, as you see. And then the problem still appears up here, where you could just do the same thing. But this doesn't really solve the problem. It just forwards the problem to your caller. And this example is really a stupid small example, of course, just to make a point. But imagine a system with a few hundreds, if not thousand classes in a hierarchy calling each other. Then more and more methods would contain those declarations of checked exceptions. Plus, like here, you have a second method throwing an interrupted exception. Now we could do the same. And now the method signature even grows. So the more methods declaring checked exceptions and not handling them, the more methods will have longer and longer method signatures, which really can be very nasty very soon. So we should really not do that. Let's revert it. Okay, so what can we do instead? We surround the code with a try catch. Now here again you see the print stack trace. And print stack trace is a bit problematic because it collects the whole stack, of course. And this may use a lot of memory, actually. And then printing, of course, again, uses a lot of resources. So you should also prevent that. Now it depends. The best way of handling an exception, of course, is really doing something to help the client. For example, reading from a different source. I didn't really have much prepared. But we could imagine we would have a database reader. I'm just simulating this here. Let's say read from database. Yeah, now this method isn't implemented, of course. We would have to implement it. And I mean, this might not be so object oriented. You could also have a retry mechanism directly in your reader. But, I mean, we're not going there. I just want to tell you, the best option is to handle the exception and like with a retry mechanism. And the best way is to handle it as early as possible. If you cannot handle it in such a way, it might also be okay to at least log the exception. So, for logging, you should use a logging framework. And Okay, so we have the message in the exception, which would also print the stack trace later on. Error. Most people I see using a logging framework and logging an exception, they would always use error. But sometimes it might also be just enough to log on one level, because I would only log on error level when there is something that the operations team can do about the and should do about the exception, like restarting a server or system or database. But if this problem is solved in a different way or is not so problematic for some reason, one might just also be enough. So just don't, I mean, the problem is people just write what they're used to, and as everyone writes error, then they do just the same because they all see an error is logged as error. But this is not necessarily true. You should really think of the logging level that that is really sufficient for you. Okay. Besides checked exceptions, I mean, every method call could also produce a runtime exception. So let's also handle this in here as an example. Okay. As for the logging level, all the same rules apply. But there's one tiny difference. For runtime exceptions, it might be better to log using the toString method, because there are some exceptions like the null pointer exception that would not contain a message. And then logging the message, you would just see an empty string. So if you use toString, you at least would see the name of the class that was thrown, like null pointer exception, which might be helpful. Okay, what else can we do? For checked exception, there's actually even another way of handling. Well, it's not really handling the exception, but anyway. Because, I mean, first of all, which I haven't explained yet, why actually are there checked exceptions in Java? What was the original idea? Well, it turned out it was not such a smart idea. The idea was that having a checked exception would force you to handle it, but this means you have to have a way of handling it. But sometimes you might not have a way of handling it, and then it doesn't really make sense to have a checked exception. So you might just as well wrap the checked exception with a runtime exception. Okay, here I just used the generic runtime exception. You might also declare your own exception extending runtime exception, which is probably nicer. But here for our little example, I just want to show how to wrap exceptions. Checked exceptions, I mean. And now the good thing is, as we're wrapping it, for the compiler, it's not a checked exception anymore. It's a runtime exception. And a runtime exception doesn't have to be handled. So now it's perfectly fine that you throw this exception. It does not have to be handled in here either. And you can propagate this all the way up. And then you would have just one final catch block that would log all runtime exceptions or handle all runtime exceptions in some generic way. And yeah, one more really evil thing that I've seen quite often actually, which you should please never ever do. Don't do this at home, and especially not at work. Log and rethrow. It's really problematic for various reasons. One is, I mean, you're logging the exception here. Throwing it again will probably also log the exception or handle it in some way. And this duplicates usually logging messages. So this can really clutter your log. Monitoring is really important. Seeing when which exception happens, for what reason, and so being able to handle it and to fix, like if there is a bug, fix the bug. So for monitoring, you should also have an exact statistics of which exception happens how many times. And yeah, logging one exception twice, probably even more, if you do this in the hierarchy more often. I've seen systems where one simple exception was easily logged 10 times in the hierarchy. So this really clutters your log. Don't do it. Thank you. And then also about logging, one more thing. Let's imagine we have some, usually you would have some parameters. Parameter one. Oh, sorry. And now I use an object. Oh, no, I call it parameter two. Okay. What you should usually do is, if possible, don't log just the generic message, either in front, but probably even better in the back. Log the values of your parameters that brought you to that exception. This will really be helpful when you try to find the reason for an exception. And for objects, it's really helpful if you always, for your own objects, implement override the toString method. Doing this will allow you to log the whole object in the case of an error. Okay, I mean, not perfect yet, actually not even correct yet, but I hope you get the idea. The reason why I put the parameters to the back is for filtering. This would probably, this message would probably appear a few times, while the value of the parameters would probably be very specific for each object differently. So for filtering, it makes it more easy if the generic part is in the front to the left side. Okay. While we're talking about logging, I mean, this is not exception handling, but I might just as well also add some words about logging in general. I also see many people logging a lot of stuff on debug level. This should be really prevented. You have a debugger. If you don't know how to use it, learn how to use it. Debugging, especially lots of debugging, can easily slow down your performance. So one reason why debugging would be okay-ish, for example, if you have a QA team, external QA team, that wants to check if certain methods are called. So if that is a necessity in your team, at least say if log is debug enabled. Because, well, in my small example, I just have an empty string, which would be simple, but usually it's not so simple and you have lots of parameters, even two string methods called, and the object could easily consist of other objects in a hierarchy. So calling a toString method can compute a lot of stuff. And so in here, it's not problematic because when an exception happens, we already are facing a problem. And I mean, I would expect that your system, that this is really an exceptional case and not the main case. But in here, this would always be used whenever debug is enabled. So this is a bit different case. So first of all, don't enable debug on production probably. And if you have that log is debug enabled, then this code doesn't have to be executed in here. some people even would not have even a single debug, but even like entering method and leaving method and that. No, 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 this is really ugly. Please don't do that. Use your debugger. Last but not least, there's also an info level. You could say is info enabled, but this really depends, because it depends on how your production settings are set. Usually on production, you might have info log level as default. And if it's default anyway, then you can just as well go without checking if it's enabled, if you know it's enabled anyway. But then use logging info also sparsely. Your operation team would probably like it to see some messages popping up if an important server or system is starting. But I would really only do it in big starting up processes and not in small methods that are called constantly. Yeah. Okay. So much from my side so far. I hope you enjoyed my little video. You can send me an email to info@marcus-beal.com. And see you next time. Bye.